and your warm hospitality. Wednesday late evening, so many people eagerly wanting to listen about a topic like tax. Let me make clear, it's not about cricket today or Bollywood. See, it never rarely happens that somebody gets up in the morning and says, "Chalo yaar, aaj kuch tax bharte hain." So I can't imagine that tax can be such an exciting topic of standing room only. So, but I'm quite happy, and I will try and share some my understanding of this topic. I can't imagine how can tax be made into a terribly interesting topic. But I am struck by what Sudhindra said. He talked about Vedavyasa and honeybee and all. But what he didn't tell you, or what maybe Vedavyasa also didn't say, is that all that honey which is collected, which is the pot of honey for the politicians. So that is the real thing. You know, what happens to that pot of honey after? No doubt they come and. In fact, for those of you or those of us who are salaried employees, we never see the full salary anyway. Because before you know it, the government has put its hand in your pocket before the end of the month. So what you see is minus 6%. I'm just reminded that in July 2008, there was an incident where there was a vote in parliament where there was a danger that the government would have collapsed. The Prime Minister was willing to bet his entire government on the success or failure of a vote in parliament. I don't know if you remember, July 2008, right? Do you remember that vote?
I don't do well. Yes, you're the receiving end.
Yeah, I think he went to jail for that. In fact, after that incident was over, he got the phrase which became popular, which was called "Singh is King." So the issue was that the Prime Minister mainly used all his moral force or courage or determination, whatever you call it, daav pe lagaya. You know, he put the I'm going to have a vote in parliament and a show of strength. And there was a danger that if the vote failed, the government would have fallen. So what was this issue? The issue was getting parliament to ratify the Indo-US civil nuclear deal. Is it working? So this was the vote in parliament. Okay. I'm not going to go into the incident which got Sudhindra into trouble. But the media and the newspapers, I think, did some survey around the country. Logon ko pucha, kya aap jante hain, you know, there is this Indo-US civil nuclear deal ki baat chal rahi hai. It turns out that 70 to 80% of the country had no clue what was all this big fuss about. Why was the government, why was the Prime Minister willing to bet his whole government on an issue? Many people really, I mean, that is what sometimes I'm reminded of GST. Everybody is talking about it, and abhi to Amitabh Bachchan has become brand ambassador. So what is this GST? Itna exciting kuch hona hi chahiye. That's why I was, you know, maybe standing room. On WhatsApp, you're getting this thing, you know. आता जी एस टी येईल ती भरायची आणि पटापट 1 जुलैला जायचं घरी आरडाओरड करायची नाही असं एस टी परिवहन मंडळाकडनं सूचना आली आहे. सो दोज ऑफ युअर नो मराठी विल नो दॅट. सो जी एस टी इज ऑफकोर्स लॉट ऑफ जोक्स आर कमिंग ऑन दॅट. सो लेट्स सो माय जॉब टुडे जस्ट टू शेअर सम अंडरस्टँडिंग व्हॉट दिस इज. सो नंबर वन, as you said, unlike demonetization, which happened last year on 8th of November, at 8 o'clock in the evening on television, the Prime Minister announced this thing, big dhamaka called demonetization. And that came as a big surprise. Nobody was prepared for it. Unlike that, some people are saying GST is also like a dhamaka, but it is not a surprise thing. We have been talking about this for at least 16, 17 years. So that's the first point to note. This is a reform which has been discussed, debated, analyzed, you know, threadbare. So this is not a big surprise. Secondly, this is a reform which is a fundamental in nature, because it is moving the entire tax system, indirect tax system of the country, from production-based to consumption-based. So it's a consumption tax. And we are moving the... our tax system consists of two parts, two types, direct taxes and indirect taxes. Direct taxes are those that come out of your income or your earning. An example of that is income tax. The tax that you pay is proportional to your income. So you can get your income as a salary, as a profit, or through some capital gains by buying and selling of shares or whatever. Those are called direct taxes. Indirect taxes, so it is quite fashionable sometimes to say only 3% of the country pays indirect tax. Direct taxes. So 97% people are not paying direct taxes. So bahut log chidte hain, especially salaried class, they say, you know, we don't even get a chance to see our full salary. And look at those guys. So first big myth we have to dispel is that while it is true that direct taxes are paid by about 3% of the population, these 3% are roughly 36 or 40 million people. Each of them is an income earner. Typically, they have a family of four. So 35 million into four, it represents 140 million people of India. It represents 14% of the population. And infants or elderly people are not supposed to pay. So if you remove that population, then as a percentage of people who are able to pay taxes, uska population percentage lenge, it must be 20-25%. So the picture looks very different if you start, but it's very fashionable to say only 3% are paying. And that's not to deny, I don't want to leave the impression that that's not to deny that more people should be paying income tax. But sometimes the picture becomes distorted. But when it comes to indirect taxes, everybody pays. Everybody has to bear the burden. So when you buy a packet of soap, when you buy a chappal, when you buy a shirt, all that has indirect tax components. So maybe 3 or 4 or 20% of the population pays direct taxes, but 100% of the population pays indirect taxes, direct and indirect. And direct taxes, by their very nature, are proportional to your income, whereas indirect taxes are not proportional to your income. So a 15% tax on a chappal or a 15% tax on when you go to a restaurant to eat a dosa is the same amount of money that you pay. If it's a 100 rupee dosa, 15 rupees is paid by whether you are Mr. Ketkar or Mr. Kulkarni or Mr. Ambani, Mr. Ranade, Mr. whoever. So it is doesn't depend on what is your income. So in that sense, if your income is lower, then that 15 rupees pinches you more than if your income was more. So the pinch of an indirect tax is actually higher for relatively poor people. So in that sense, indirect taxes are inherently unfair, unjust, regressive. Our country, our system of taxes has two parts, direct taxes and indirect taxes. Of the total tax collected, including state level taxes and center, only 35% is collected as direct taxes and 65% is collected as indirect taxes. And this ratio is actually exactly the opposite of rest of the world, or at least the developed world, where the ratio should be much more from indirect taxes and much less from indirect taxes. And the big reform that we are talking about today, GST, is actually a massive indirect tax. In fact, it is being expanded to the whole country and all sectors. Indirect taxes so far were mainly in the form of excise duties paid by factories on their products and service tax paid by service providers. So now what we are doing is integrating the whole thing into GST, goods and service tax. But it's an indirect tax. And to the extent that if we have not done direct tax reform, then it is an incomplete task. In fact, it may end up making the system even more unfair. I'm using strong words like unjust, unfair, but I hope you understand what I mean. Because the principle of taxation says, A, that it should be efficient. So like he said, that pluck the honeybee and all that. Secondly, it should be fair. Efficient and fair. Efficient means that it should not cause too much distortion. It should not cause people to start doing weird things. I believe there was a time, I can give so many examples of how taxes induce weird behavior. There was a small-scale industry, reservation for shampoos, I believe, where if your turnover was below 20 lakh rupees, then your excise duty was 5%, otherwise it was 25% or something. So there was a mushrooming of many small-scale firms with 19,000, 99,000. So that is an example of a distortion. So anyway, the principles of taxation says that it should be efficient and also fair. What is fair? Fairness means vertical equity and horizontal equity. That vertical equity means that if you are richer, then you should have a higher burden, higher tax share. So if two people, one is rich and one is less rich or poor, then the rich person should pay slightly higher taxes. That is called the notion of vertical fairness or vertical equity. Horizontal fairness or horizontal equity means that two people earning the same income should have the same tax burden. Indirect taxes violate this principle. Indirect taxes violate this principle. And even in direct taxes, we have this violation of this principle, because if you are earning all your income through dividends, suppose you own a big company and you get, you know, like the... I'm tempted to take names, but I won't. But let's say the promoters or founders of, say, Infosys, their annual income may be hundreds of crores, but it's all in the form of dividends, and that's completely tax-free. But if you get 3 lakh rupees of salary annually, 20,000 rupees per month, 3.6 lakh rupees salary, you have to pay 10%, 20% income tax. So this somehow, prima facie, seems to violate the principle of horizontal equity. Vertical equity. So we want a tax system to be both fair and efficient. And to that extent, that while GST is, a reform, and I'll explain what the reform aspects are, but if we don't reform direct taxes as well, this task is incomplete. When we refer to that Kelkar task force or Kelkar committee on tax reforms, that was in two parts. Kelkar Committee on Direct Taxes and Kelkar Committee on Indirect Taxes. So we have not yet touched the other thing, the other big elephant. There are two elephants. So I just want to remind you that direct tax reform is still pending. Okay. So the big thing about this GST is that it is moving system from production to consumption. Secondly, it represents, why is it a big reform? Because it represents a massive grand bargain among 29 states of India, 29 states and 7 union territories and the central government. What have they done? This is really the true spirit of cooperative federalism. And it is quite remarkable that we brought this consensus that all the states of India currently enjoy the rights of imposing a sales tax on you. There are many other taxes, but basically a big source of income for state governments is VAT. We call it VAT, value-added tax, but basically it's a sales tax. For example, Maharashtra government collects something like 1 lakh crores. Anybody know this number? 1.2 lakh crores. I think Abhishek may know. 1.2 lakh crores is collected in the form of just VAT. And then there is other forms of excises, liquor excise. For many states, this is a very big source of their income, state revenues. So this grand bargain is that state governments have state governments do not impose service tax, they only impose sales tax which is on merchandise, and the central government has surrendered its right to impose excise and service tax. So all these parties have come together in a grand bargain, have given up their rights, respective taxation rights, in exchange for this grand scheme of GST. Okay, so that is why that's the second point. The first point is that we have moved from production to consumption. So the point, multiple points of taxation nahi hoga. Second point is that this is a grand bargain between, it's a cooperative federalism. Of course, it had to be validated by a constitutional amendment. I think this was, if I'm not mistaken, the 100th amendment or 101st amendment of India's constitution. So this is, to in my mind, I think the only case in India's history, and please correct me if I'm wrong, only time in India's history where all members of Lok Sabha who were present, and that day I think 543 were present, they were 545 or 543 were present, and all members of Rajya Sabha, 250 or something, everybody voted in favor of this constitutional amendment. So they tally the votes for 543, against zero. Rajya Sabha for 250 or 248, against zero. The Lok Sabha voted for it in earlier, and Rajya Sabha voted for it in May, I think last year, 1 year ago. only time I know that actually a constitutional amendment has passed with not only absolute majority, 100% vote. So you can see that this is amazing. Second point. Third point, cascading. We will be avoiding cascading of taxes. So basically, in the excise system, you pay a tax at when the goods leave the factory gate. Uske baad it goes to a wholesaler, then to a retailer, then to a ultimate distribution. So there are, the system of taxation is such that there is a tax on tax. Eventually, you pay tax on the MRP or whatever. I don't want to get into too many details. But the system was susceptible to tax on tax, which is called cascading of tax, which is very wasteful. And it's, that's why at some point, we moved away from that cascading system of excise taxation towards what is called value-added taxation. I don't know if you heard the word mod VAT. So modified VAT is basically when we moved away from the plain, very, very inefficient cascading type of excise tax system to VAT. And from VAT, mod VAT, sorry. And from there, so I won't go into the history. I was just telling Surinder earlier how in 2005, we actually had an agreement between all states of India to go to an harmonized system of VAT. So what used to happen is that different states used to have different VAT, which is what we call in sales tax. So if you cross the border in Goa, in Coimbatore, your shirt might have been 3% VAT. In Maharashtra, it is 12%. Somewhere else. So we moved to a system of harmonized VAT. But even then, you had this multiple tax rates. So as I'm saying, before I forget, so the third point is that this cascading will go away now. So let me just repeat. Can I just borrow your pen? Oh, sorry. I think it's writing. I just want to not take too much of your time, but at least I want to make at least the major points. So the first point was production to consumption. Second point was about the grand bargain. Third point is about eliminating cascading. Okay, that we don't have tax on tax anymore. And fourth point is that because everything is going to be online or it's going to be computerized, there is an interlocking of incentives. So the way the tax system will now work is that it has moved from production to consumption. So we are not going to tax at the factory gate. We are going to tax at the point of final transaction. It's a transaction tax, a consumption tax. So I am selling you a product and I am charging 18% tax. So I am supposed to pay 18% to Government of India's GST. But my actual tax burden is what is proportional to the value I am adding. So let's say I am selling you something, but my input cost is XYZ. I'm selling you something, but I bought some material ingredients, put them together and sold you. So that, when I bought that also was subject to GST. So I will get tax credit. So that is called getting input tax credit. So if I'm selling you a good for 100 rupees and charging 18 rupees tax, so I'm selling it to you for 118 rupees, but I had to buy some 65 rupees worth of inputs. And on that 65 rupees also included the GST from that guy. So I will, from that 18 rupees of tax that I have paid, I will get back 12 rupees from Government of India. Okay, that is called input tax credit. That's why the ultimate tax that I will pay will be only on the value that I add, which is I take a bunch of things, inputs of 65 rupees and add value, put them together or do some design, make it 100 rupees worth. So my tax burden should be only that value added. So I will get a refund. But I can get a refund only if I can produce proof that my vendor, my supplier has paid that tax. Therefore, there is an interlocking incentive. I will only deal with vendors who will give me proof that they have paid tax. This will, of course, all be electronic. It won't be actually physical paper. So there is interlocking incentives of people to abide and tax compliance. Do you understand what I'm saying? To give you a crude example, similarity, in microfinance, so you heard of Grameen Bank? So, Bachat Ghat, that a loan is given to a particular woman and she is part of a group of, say, 10 other women. Tensa Bachat Ghat asto. So, 10 women self-help group. A loan is given of, say, 10,000 rupees to one woman to be repaid in 52 installments week after week in 1 year. But if she defaults, if there is any default of repayment, then the entire group of 10 is blacklisted. There is no collateral. Unlike all other loans, you know, if you try to take a car loan, a housing loan, it is against the property. So it's loan against your flat, loan against your car. But this microfinance loans are without any collateral. The only collateral is that if you default, if you don't repay, all 10 of you will be penalized. So no more loans, no more repeat loans for anybody. So this enforces a repayment discipline. So because there is interlocking incentives, nobody wants the borrowing person to default. Similarly, in this buyer-seller relationship in VA, in GST, there is interlocking incentives that I am going to deal, I am going to insist on proof of tax paid by my supplier. So he better pay. Similarly, if I am going to sell to somebody and I am part of a value chain, my customer is also going to ask me proof. Arey boss, I have to also get a refund. Oh, batao. So this will increase tax compliance. This will decrease tax evasion. This will increase tax compliance. Now you will say, kitna paperwork hoga? The whole idea is it will be all online. And now, of course, you will say, no, dekhenge. You know, there was a time, I don't know how some of you are old enough to remember, that railway booking was without online. It's even heretical to say it today. Even the remotest of villagers today now use online railway booking. So don't think that this making everything online or making everything computerized on this interlocking incentives is all that far-fetched. It will happen. It will take some time. But that is one more feature of this interlocking incentives. What else? Then, therefore, because of this tax compliance and because of this interlocking incentives of paying taxes and less tax evasion, tax collection is going to go up. I expect that the tax collection will go up. But the tax collection will go up only if the rates are modest. So that's why there was a discussion of what should be the GST rate. The GST rate should have been, according to the Kelkar Task Committee, originally of 2002 or 2003, should have been 12%. Abhi thoda thoda drift karti, it has come to 18. And in fact, we no longer have this simple, pure, ideal GST system with just one rate. You know, if you go to Singapore, if you go to Japan and all, whether you are buying a cup of tea or buying a big stereo system or buying clothes or shoes, there's just one GST, there's one rate. Which is whatever. In Singapore, I think it's 7% or something like that. 7.5%. In our country, we are going to have 0, 5, 12, 18, 26, and 43. 28 and 43, sorry. So it doesn't look like one nation, one tax. But at least it's a progress. Because remember, we have something like 600-700 items on which taxes have been defined. And if you have multiple tax rates across 29 states of India, they calculated how many actually tax slabs do we have. The GST Council thinks about these things. We have something like 1,800 tax slabs. This is 20. So that 1,800 is coming down to 6. So we should be thankful about it. This is progress. Some of you may be skeptical, but this is really progress. Ideally, we want to go to one rate, but this is progress. And in this bargaining, what has happened, so these rates are decided no longer by the Finance Minister of India or the ruling party or one individual state. It is decided by the GST Council. And the GST Council is the political animal. By the way, GST Council has not been recognized by any law of parliament nor by the constitution, but it has legitimacy. GST Council, the members of the state finance minister and of course finance minister of India and so on, and they decide things by having a meeting and discussing. I don't think anybody has a veto power. I think it's one person, one vote. But they have to decide. So they have to decide on what should get what rate. So you must have read in the newspapers that laddus from Tirupati and hair. I mean, I don't have much experience, but hair and laddus have 0% tax. So this was being negotiated. Then kites. So apparently, the Marathi mantat chainichi vastu ani avashyak, luxury goods and necessities. So the idea that necessities we should keep at 0% or 5%. So food and medicine, insulin, let's say. And so what is chainichi? What is a luxury good? So it looks like hair and laddus are necessities because Andhra insisted. इस पे 0% ही होना चाहिए. काइट्स, सो काइट्स बिहार सेज दैट दिस ये तो लग्जरी गुड, इस पे 18% or 28% लगाओ. बट गुजरात से नो नो नो, काइट्स आर नेसेसिटी. आई थिंक दे आर एक्सपर्ट्स एट काइट फ्लाइंग, बट देयरफॉर काइट्स हैव 5%. सो दिस इज द जीएसटी काउंसिल का पॉलिटिकल खिचड़ी एंड मसाला. But this is democracy. This is the way it's going to be. There's, we can't, ideally we would like have to have one rate or just two rates. It should have been just us, it should have been just 5 and 12 according to me. But unfortunately we have to live with this. Hopefully we will further, when we make more progress, we'll collapse it into three rates. But what goes into what is, I mean, now they are saying that if you go into a, so hotel rooms, if the room costs more than 7,500 rupees, then it's a luxury, so 28%. Otherwise, it's 12%. If you go to a restaurant, if it is air-conditioned, then it's luxury. If it's non-air-conditioned, then it's 12%. So all this unfortunate masala is going on. And it is, what happens is that the more the categories and the more the slabs and the definitions, I think it invites room for disputes, for litigation, and more importantly, corruption. So the more you give discretionary powers to tax inspectors, and you know, then there'll be somebody will object, somebody will dispute, then take to court, tribunals. So this we don't always capture those costs. Those are all costs, which are slow burning costs. You know, like 1,000 cuts, you bleed from 1,000 cuts, and aggregate costs may be very high of this litigation. For example, do you know that in India, total amount of money locked up in tax disputes? Can you imagine what the number is? 5 lakh crores. 5 lakh crores. 5 trillion rupees. That is 5 into 12 zeros, is it? Or 15 zeros? 5 lakh, 12 zeros. Thank you. Only 12 zeros. So what are these disputes? That there's been a tax demand. Okay? So you object, you say, nahi, ye galat hai. Then it goes to a tax, first it goes to the tax inspector. You have a meeting with the commissioner. I'm saying all the kosher process. Let me not mention what happens non-kosher. So then you prove, you produce evidence. It's wrongly. So then you say, okay, but I don't agree with it. So let's go to an adjudicator, which is called a tribunal. So the tribunal also gives a judgment in your favor. The case should be closed. I'm right, you please, you know, take back your tax demand. But if the tax inspector, tax official does that, there is that hanging sword of CAG, CBI, CVC, all the various Cs, chief vigilance officer, chief... So the person doesn't want to take a risk. He may be accused of inka so kuch chal raha hai, you know, inka kuch secret nata hai. He's, why is this fellow... So whether he believes or not believes, the tribunal judgment automatically goes into appeal. If he doesn't appeal, if he doesn't file an appeal, he may be accused of doing a favor to the tax assessee. Assessee. People who pay taxes are not assessed, but assessees. So it goes to the court, then it goes to a higher court. So the whole process keeps on going. At no level can any government official afford to say, okay, maaf kiya, khatam ho gaya. Maaf kiya nahin. Okay, I accept the judgment of the judge. It's not a maaf kiya. It's actually a proper legal process. And that's why this money gets locked up. Now, I have not got my tax refund legitimate. I know my case is solid. So, mera paisa atka hua hai. Because my money is locked up, I'm not investing. So, investment is held up. Make in India is held up. The aggregate number is 5 lakh crores. And often the disputed amount is 50,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees, 5 lakh rupees. We are not talking about big, big amounts. There was a Vodafone dispute which was 12,000 crores. So forget that for the time being. That was a different issue. Maybe we'll have a session on that. I have a strong view on that. But we are talking about disputed amounts which are 3-4 lakh rupees and so on. So that is total tax dispute, okay? Usme se khali excise tax lenge, which is what GST is going to cover, is about 1.5-2 lakh crores. The amount held in pure excise disputes, excise cases. Now imagine when you have these 5-6 slabs, you're going to, you know, room for dispute and litigation is there. So why didn't we, anyway. So that was my fifth point, I think, that at least we have collapsed it to 5 rates or 6 rates. But we have, by this selective definition and classification, we have kept the door open for disputes. And final point, I think two more points I'll make. This tax buoyancy, you know, I said that if you had kept the rate low, then because people, you know, the lower the rate, the more likely that people comply. Because, you know, if you're going to evade or if you're going to kind of cheat on taxes, there's a cost involved. You might go to jail or something. So generally lower the rate, the compliance possibility is higher. So if the rate was 12%, which is what Mr. Kilkar committee had recommended, I think we would have actually seen tax buoyancy. I told you tax collection is likely to go up because of the interlocking incentives. And tax buoyancy would have been, that means it would have gone up. But such was the fear of all the states that we may lose out on revenue. And therefore, the rates went up. And one more big factor was that today, we have left something like 35% of GDP outside GST. This is a shocking fact. That while here is a comprehensive system of indirect taxes in the country, but almost 35% of GDP or economic activity has been excluded for the time being. What are this? Real estate transactions. Petrol, diesel, alcohol, tobacco, electricity, lawyers. Acha. Lawyers. How do you spell that? L-I-A-R-S. Yeah, so now, you know, by keeping all these things, so what has happened is the tax base on which you're going to construct your GDP, GST system, instead of being the whole pie, it's going to be a subset. And you have to recover the same revenues that you're getting. So obviously the rate that is, average rate that you have to work with is higher. Because I think the Kelkar task force assumptions were that you're going to collect taxes on all transactions. So therefore you can keep the rate low. But now you have excluded this. Why are they excluded? Because one big reason is that because state governments get huge amount of revenue from petrol, diesel, and alcohol. In fact, there are states in India which almost half the revenues, I think Abhishek's team has done this research, that half the revenues of state governments comes from liquor. They literally survive on liquor, I mean taxes. So they don't want to, that cannot come into, and same thing with petrol and diesel. And another one big problem in this, we are in this city of Mumbai, it gets 8,000 or 9,000 crores from octroi. And that's a very totally different question, set of issues, where Mumbai city has an autonomous sarvabhum kamanta swayat. We have a right on one source of revenue, which is Mumbai city is alone and nobody can touch it. It's called octroi. That's going to go away. That's a peculiarly Mumbai ka problem. It's not an all India problem. So we don't know how that will be reimbursed or where will that money come from. 9,000 crores is not a small amount. In fact, 9,000 crores is more than the budget of many states of India. Mumbai city's budget is something like 37,000 crores, 36,000. So that is the reason why the rate is higher. And last point is on fairness. So I think I touched it in the beginning, but let me end by again saying that point, that we have to understand that this GST is ultimately an indirect tax. And the reason, by the way, we have the 0, 5, 12 and all that, people are, the politicians, ultimately it's a political decision. They don't want the relatively poor to suffer because of high taxes. Therefore, the goods that supposedly only poor people consume, they are taxed at 0 or 5. And what rich people consume is at high rate. We talked about the luxury versus thing. But it's a very arbitrary classification. And why should we deny, let's say, if it's an aspirational thing? Arre, main gareeb hoon, lekin I want to wear Nike shoes. Whatever, you know. So it's a very murky thing. So I'm saying really the cleaner tax system is to progressively move away from indirect taxes towards direct taxes. So that mix of 35-65, unless we make it 50-50 at least, or if not actually 60-40 or something like that, it is going bound to keep this messiness of indirect taxes. So to that extent, we should remember. No, I'm not going to, it's like saying, everybody, please don't think of pink elephants. Which means everybody's thinking of pink elephants. So I was going to say, I'm not going to mention the topic of agricultural income tax. I just did. So I'm saying when I say direct taxes, I mean taxes on all kinds of income. So a direct tax or an income tax should not look at the where is the tax coming from. It doesn't depend on the smell of the income. Meaning it doesn't depend. So if we start moving towards that, that can we have a situation where every rupee that you earn or every rupee above 2 lakh rupees that you earn is subject to income tax. Now the question is how do you chase that income? People, you know, notoriously they are very clever. Nobody knows how much income. Even a husband and wife don't know each other's income. So that's a different. So that problem we need to crack. But basically, if we can move towards direct taxes, I think then only this GST will really, the punch that it is supposed to pack. So I didn't mention, for example, what impact it will have on GDP. It's supposed to go up. What impact it will have on inflation. Short term, there will be higher inflation, but medium to long term, prices actually are going to stabilize and come down. But all that real packing, the punch in this reform will happen only when the system of tax reform is more comprehensive, meaning both indirect and direct taxes, more comprehensive coverage of the GST, not just 65% of GDP, and simplification of the rates, simplification of the classification discretion that's given now, and fewer rates and all that. So I think I'll stop here. I've taken too much time, but we'll be happy to take some questions. Thank you.